Thanks for joining me for this session. Today we're going to talk pet photography. My name's Ashley Ondercheck. I'm a Sony imaging specialist. Let's get right into it. So the first thing we'll start with is going to be lens selection, or which lens to choose when we're photographing our favorite pet. Wide-angle lenses are a great choice. It allows you to incorporate a lot of the environment in with that pet. Some of the options that you'll have in a wide-angle lens might be a 12 to 24 millimeter lens, a 16 to 35 millimeter lens, or if you're using an APS-C size camera, you can also use the 10 to 18 millimeter lens. Portrait lenses or prime lenses make for great pet photography as well. These work fantastic when I'm photographing in low light, because the apertures just open up and let in so much more light. They also work great for hiding the background. If I have a busy or distracting background, I can really help blur and hide that background as well. You have tons of options in these. They're going to vary anything from the 50 millimeter lenses in a 1.8 or 1.4 aperture, 85 millimeter lenses in a 1.8 or 1.4 aperture, all the way up to the 135 millimeter. So you have a ton of choices in these lenses. Most of these portrait lenses, I would say, are going to be in that 50 millimeter to 135 millimeter range. Telephoto lenses are also great, especially if you have an outdoor dog who really likes to get out and run. This allows you to reach great distances. The other added benefit of having a telephoto lens is you get a great thing called lens compression, which really flattens the image and makes the background just melt away. Telephoto lenses come in all shapes and sizes. You have everything from the 70 to 300 millimeter lens, the 70 to 200 millimeter lenses in f4 or 2.8, up to the 100 to 400 and 200 to 600 millimeter lens. So it really just depends how far you want to reach. What I would call the multi-purpose lenses. These are going to be lenses that are fantastic for going on a walk, going to the dog park, things of that nature. They just cover a great range. So you have things like the 24 to 105, the 24 to 70 in both the F4 Zeiss version and the 2.8 G Master version as well. If you're photographing on an APS-C size sensor camera, the 18 to 135 millimeter lens is another great choice. All right, let's talk about some camera settings. So these will just be different features in the camera that we can enable to get better images as well. First thing we're going to talk about though is going to be autofocus settings. So first we'll go over autofocus modes, and then we'll go over autofocus area. So autofocus mode is how the camera is going to focus. By default, right out of the box, it's set to AFA or autofocus auto, meaning it's going to look at the scene, and if it doesn't see movement, it's going to put the camera into an AFS mode or single autofocus mode. If it does see movement, it's going to go into an AFC or continuous autofocus mode. The difference between these two, AFS or single, is only going to refocus once I've lifted off the shutter and pressed halfway down. So as I'm photographing my pet, I'll press halfway down on the shutter button. I'll hear a confirmation beep. The camera will not refocus until I lift my finger off that shutter button and press halfway down again. So this is really going to be more used if the pet is not moving. So if they're taking a nap, laying down, or they're sitting, or they're actually waiting and posing for us, this will be a good option at that point. If our dog is more active, they're out running, they're moving around, then I'm going to want to put the camera into AFC or continuous autofocus. The advantage here is once I press halfway down on that shutter button, I won't get a confirmation beep from the camera. Instead, the camera is going to continuously refocus as my subject moves closer or further from me. The benefit here is while my dog is out playing at the park, instead of just that first shot being in focus, it's going to continually refocus as I'm taking pictures. So as they move closer to me, it's going to keep refocusing, and I'm going to have more keepers at the end of the day. talking about autofocus area. So previously we talked about how the camera focuses. Now we're going to look at where the camera focuses. You have a whole bunch of options available to you in the Sony cameras. Everything from wide to zone to center to flexible spot. Wide is actually going to look at every focus point available in the camera. So it's going to take advantage of, in some cameras, up to 693 points of focus. So tons of information to look at. The good and the bad here is, the good is it's taking advantage of all those focus points in that camera. So it's giving you lots of options. The unfortunate side is it's going to follow some automatic protocols. And one of those is whatever's closest to the frame or closest to the camera is going to take priority, which sometimes might mean that it's not going to focus exactly where I want it to. And this can lead to, with some pet shots, having a nice sharp nose, but not sharp eyes. And really, this is going to fall into a couple things. If I have a larger aperture on the lens, like a 5.6 or an f8, I'll have enough depth of field, I won't run into this. But if I'm trying to use one of those more portrait lenses, like a 1.8, then there's a couple different things I maybe want to set up in the camera that will take better advantage of how these machines can focus for us. One way we can go about it is starting to limit the area that the camera looks at. So we can do that by going into zone autofocus. Instead of it looking at all of those focus points available, it's looking at a smaller grouping of those focus points. The trade-off here is that it's still front priority, meaning it's still looking at the closest thing to the camera as priority to focus on. I can set the camera to be center point focus. Now it's only looking at the center cluster of focus points. This is nice for me as the photographer because I actually know where the camera is going to look to focus every time. It's not really a guessing game. The downside is I don't always want my subject right in the middle of the frame either. So I want to be able to maybe put my subject off to the side, things like that. And that's where flexible spot comes into play. Flexible spot, I have the option of a small, medium, or large sized focus point. So I can actually choose small and get a very fine focus point on it. I can also move that focus point wherever I want it to go. So I can put it right on the dog's eye and make sure that I'm actually focusing right where I want it to focus. It's easy enough to move this around. If you have an A7 series camera with the thumb pad on the back, there's that little thumb pad, and just moving that will move this flexible spot around on the screen. If we have an A6000 series camera or maybe an A7 II series camera that didn't have the thumb toggle on the back, there's a couple ways we can go about it. Once we've locked that flexible spot into place, you can either jump into the function menu, go into focus area, reselect your focus area at flexible spot, and then using the thumb pad, you can move that focusing point around. What I would actually recommend, though, is to set a custom button on the camera. You'll have an option either called focus setting or focus standard. And when I set that as my custom button, I can just press that one button and right away I'm back into being able to move my focus point around. Another fantastic capability in the Sony cameras is their tracking autofocus system. Previous generations of cameras had this, and it was called lock-on autofocus. What it would do is it would actually look at color, distance, and face, and using those three parameters, it would grab my subject, and as they moved through the frame, the focusing would follow them. The newer generation of cameras have what we call real-time tracking autofocus. So they're looking at those same three parameters, but now it's also looking at pattern and looking for an eye. And it just makes it a much more accurate system. It's unbelievably better, honestly. It's night and day difference to the point where it makes my job as the photographer incredibly easy. Another option we have to really take control of focus is animal eye autofocus. For pets, this is a fantastic piece of technology. So that same technology that was available to us with people is now available for our pets as well, and it works great with dogs and cats. If you want to enable this on your camera, so if you have an A7 III series camera or newer, they will have this eye autofocus functionality in them. You will go into your first camera tab on your camera, and it's usually right around page 6 or so in the autofocus options. And you'll have a face and eye autofocus settings option. And in there, you'll have a subject detection. This is a piece where I can toggle it between human and animal. What I would actually recommend is if you do a customization on your function menu, is to save this feature on your function menu. So it's just really quick to toggle back and forth. Do note that after you're done photographing your pet, you may want to switch this back to human because it will not jump to human if it's left on animal. So you will have to switch it back and forth. And then you can also toggle that eye display. So if you want to actually see the little green box, make sure you have that enabled as well. This feature honestly works incredibly good, especially if I have pets when I'm photographing them that are posed. So whether they're sitting at the park or they're laying on the bed, whatnot. But it is a great feature when they're posing or just kind of stationary. If they're really active and moving, I still prefer to use the lock-on tracking autofocus. Just it's a much easier way to track them through the frame. But this works fantastic when they're posed like this for me. Silent shutter is another great feature we can take advantage of. This is really, really great when the dogs are asleep and I don't want to wake them up. I can actually enable silent shutter, and what it's going to do is take advantage of that scan of the imaging sensor, and it will disable the actual shutter curtain in the camera. So what we get is a noise-free photography experience. And this works fantastic. I can be sitting there snapping away and they don't even know you're there. Well, they probably know I'm there. They're just ignoring me. Exposure compensation is another tool that we'll use quite a bit when photographing pets. And that is because cameras in general want to produce more of a neutral gray image. So when we have a dog like this that's a bright white, the camera is going to want to produce the image on the left. It's going to want to try and make it more gray, really bring down some of that brightness. But that's not the color of the fur on the dog, right? So to take advantage of this, we actually want to boost that exposure value plus one, or brighten the image, because that's the way the image actually looks. A similar option here too, or just the opposite really, if we have black dogs, what the camera is going to actually end up doing is really brightening the image, trying to again push them to more of that neutral gray. And what we want to do is push it down a stop to get them back to that true color that they are. This is a simple enough thing to adjust. On an A7 series camera, you have a little wheel up on the top right of the camera, and you can just twist that wheel to the exposure that you prefer. The nice thing with mirrorless technology is I actually see the exposure right through the viewfinder or on the back screen. So it's very simple for me to just adjust it to taste. If we have an A6000 series camera, that exposure comp will actually be just down on the thumb pad on the back of the camera. So I press down on that and I'll have a little slider left to right to make my adjustment. So let's get into some tips for improving your pet photography. First one that I would say is get on their level. Really get eye level with your pet when you're photographing them. It changes the entire dynamic of it. We have this tendency to want to just stand at our normal height and photograph all the time because it's convenient and it's where I am right now when I'm shooting. But it really does change the entire feel of the image when we get down, get low. Sometimes it may be easier just to bring them up to your eye level as well. So feel free to do that as well. We just want to make sure that we're photographing on eye level. And a lot of times I find it's easier to achieve this by using that back screen on the camera instead of using my viewfinder. So a lot of times I'll flip out that back screen and then I can hold the camera down lower, get right at eye level with them and shoot. I would also say play with your apertures. The biggest thing that you can really do is adjust this based on what I'm trying to photograph. So if I'm trying to photograph a small detail like my dog's nose or her paws, things like that, or maybe it's Christmas time, I'm trying to get some really great Christmas photos, I want those lights all nice and blurry in the background, using a small aperture number will blur and hide that background too. So maybe I'm inside the house and I have a lot of clutter, I can actually use one of those portrait lenses, open it all the way up to 1.8 or 1.4, and just that background will disappear. It's a very nice thing. But there's other times where maybe I want to show that entire background. I really want to show the environment that the dog is in. So I want to set a larger aperture number. This might be F8 or F11, just so that I can get enough detail, enough focus throughout that entire frame. Right along with that, I would say play with your shutter speeds. So faster shutter speeds are going to help us freeze action or stop my subject in place. Sometimes I'll actually set a slower shutter speed and I'll pan with my subject. And then I can produce these nice movement speed kind of images too, where it really accentuates and really shows how fast they're moving. The panning technique does take some practice. So don't think that you're going to nail this the first time. You might, but it does take some practice to get comfortable with it. The really tricky thing with pets is they move pretty sporadically. So it's kind of tough to really follow them on a run because sometimes they dart, they zig, they zag. So it does take a lot of practice to get used to this. The other thing too, practice your composition. The easiest thing here is rule of thirds. It's a great compositional rule and gives you a lot more flexibility within the frame. Also, as we've talked about using that flexible spot, it's very easy to shoot in rule of thirds because I can move that spot off to the side of the frame. I am just as guilty as anybody of this, but we get so hyper-focused, especially when we have these cute little animals, that we really stop paying attention to our backgrounds and our borders, and we allow really a lot of distractions to enter the frame. So we can get a lot of this stuff that's in the frame, whether it's the couch where the line of the couch is running straight through my dog's head, or the other distractions that are just laying around in the background that I wasn't paying attention to at the time, because I was just absorbed in the cuteness, right? So the one thing that I will say here is we need to kind of really groom the image or groom our surrounding when we go to shoot. There's a really great saying that everything in the image does one of two things. It either adds to the photo or it takes away from the photo. And we just want to make sure everything we are choosing to include in our image is adding to the quality of the photo and not detracting from it. That being said, once you've mastered all of those rules of photography, learn when you can break them. There's a lot of times where we can get creative. They don't necessarily follow a rule of composition. It's just an interesting, funny, fun image, and you can get away with that. Cuteness always wins. Props can be added as well into the images. Really search around your house. You can usually find some fun stuff that you've had saved away. Going to the pet stores or even your other different brand convenience stores, things like that, after holidays is a great way to pick up some like pet costumes and things like that at a really cheap price, especially after season. And then you've got them for the next year. And you can spend the entire year kind of building up your dog's tolerance so that when the next holiday of that comes around, you know, Halloween costumes per se, the next time Halloween comes around, they've already been pretty desensitized to that costume and they're willing to wear it and pose for you. Lighting is another big thing with pet photography. The one thing that I really can't stress enough, we want to use constant lighting when we're photographing pets. If we use strobe lighting, it tends to kind of freak them out. I know our dog really will just dart out of the room if I start using strobe lights. So we do want to start with constant lights. It's something that's a constant ray as opposed to something that's going to look like lightning and maybe scare the dog. So constant lights work great. LED panel lights work fantastic, especially because a lot of them now you can actually adjust the color temperature and the brightness, everything on the light. So the other thing too, go out and explore. Take your dog with you whenever you can. This way it gives them a chance to get out and see stuff, and it gives you great photographic opportunities as well, really capturing them out in the wild. All right, the final bit of advice, and this is going to be more on training your animal up, getting your pet comfortable for photographing. First thing, treat every photographic session like a training session. So we want to give treats, we want to reward, we want to make it a fun experience. Treats don't have to be what you go to the store and buy in the little bag. I know our dog will go crazy and eat little bits of lettuce or vegetables. She loves that almost as much as the other treats. So it can be stuff like that. It can even be a playtime session. You know, you go out for a run with them or a toy they really love. But we want to use that high reward for our photography sessions. That way they want to keep coming back and modeling for you. I found this out through photographing our dog quite a bit, and that is use your LCD screen on the back of the camera. A lot of them fold out so that I can flip it out. I can look down and see it, but I've run into more times than not that if I put the camera up in front of my face to use the viewfinder, all of a sudden the dog comes walking over because she thinks I'm hiding. Whereas if I use that LCD screen, she doesn't come walking over to the camera because she can still see my face. We want to make each of these sessions fun as well. So even if I'm getting flustered because the images aren't turning out the way I want, our dogs, our pets, they can really read that body language and they're going to not really be interested in this session either. So we want to make sure that we make it fun and enjoyable and rewarding. So if I need a break because I'm getting flustered, or if they need a break because they're just getting tired of being a model for a while, then we want to end the session and we'll come back to it at another time. Be patient and work towards those photos that you want. No great photograph happened on the very first try. A lot of these fantastic pet photos that you see have been months and months of people working with their pet, really building up the confidence, building up to that moment so that they can capture the image. So it does take time. And again, we're going to treat this as a training. So it's almost like we're teaching them a new trick. We're teaching them to be a model, right? This is going to take time to build them up, build up their comfort with it. We want to get their attention. So we want to make sure that they're looking at the camera. This can be done in a number of different ways, you know, dog whistles or clickers, or even just talking goofy to your dog. There's a lot of times that I can talk in a nice goofy voice and my dog makes the weird head tilt to try and figure out exactly what I'm doing. Those all make for great photo opportunities. So capitalize on those. The biggest thing, and really this is probably the initial learning experience a lot of us have as photographers, is our pets are going to be terrified of tripods and light stands and things of that nature when we first bring it into the scene. So if it's your pet, this is really easy. You actually can just take your tripod, set it up, put it in the room, let them walk up and smell it, sniff it, realize it's not something terrifying they have to be scared of. Same with your lighting. If we buy some LED lighting that we're going to use to maybe set up a little backdrop in a little in-home studio, set it up and then leave it in the room and let the dogs walk up and smell it and get comfortable with it, honestly. The biggest thing that you can do that will set this back is if we try and pull out something new and try and force it into a photo situation on day one, because they're going to freak out. They're not comfortable with it. So we have to give them time to build it up. If it's not my pet, if I'm photographing for a client, maybe, a lot of times I just assume that that first half hour of my session photographing with their pet, if I'm going to go photograph like a lifestyle shoot for somebody, I just assume that that first 20 to 30 minutes is really just the dog getting comfortable with me. So I'm going to pull the camera gear out, set it down. I'm going to sit there. I'm going to find out ahead of time what treats they like and bring that. And that way we can build up some comfort with each other and with the stuff I've brought, and we can have a nice productive session. The same thing is going to go for any kind of prop you want to use with your pet. If you want to start, you know, getting them to wear hats and things like that, you need to work up to it. So maybe the first time is you just put it on their head and say, good, and give them a treat and take it off. And that's how we start. So that way they start associating, hey, when I put that hat on, I get good stuff out of this. If you are having a hard time keeping your pet's attention while taking photos, or maybe you just need to focus on the camera and you can't do both, enlist a helper. Spouses work great. Children work great. Really anybody who can stand behind you and talk to the dog or make the clicking noises or blowing the whistle, what have you, just to get the dog's attention. And the final thing is listen to your pets. They will tell you a ton just in their body language. If they start being kind of dismissive of the whole session or turning away from the session, that's when you know it's time to end it. We'll come back to it another day. We can hammer at it tomorrow again. And again, it's a build-up process. So continually work with this, and eventually you're going to get some fantastic photos. I hope you enjoyed the session today. My name is Ashley, and thanks for watching.